pH sign, some color. Okay, good.
Graduating class of 1996, you may be seated. Hey, I've always wanted to do that. Okay. You can be seated too. All right. Well, we want to welcome you to this great evening, or this great afternoon, I should say. Seems like it's evening. Again, we apologize not being in the stadium, although with the rains coming, I think we made the best decision to gather here in the gym. And our prayer is that you take full advantage of this baccalaureate service, that you just enter right in and just make yourself at home and just be relaxed, because this is your service. This is your time to just be at ease and reflect. And I pray that you receive everything that you can possibly receive on this great service. We'd like you all to stand up again and have the four they'll be leading in the Pledge of Allegiance come at this time. Let's all stand.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, at this time we'll have Sarah Withenshaw come, and also Jessica Goulet come and lead in an invocation. Amen. You can remain standing.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you for this time that we have to come here, Lord, and I thank you that you've brought us this far, Lord, and I just pray that you just continue to guide us and keep us, Lord. I just pray that you just help us to stay strong in our faith as we go out into the world, Lord, and I just pray that we continue to remember that you are our Savior and you are our God, Lord, and that you can give us peace about everything, Lord, and I just thank you for that, and I thank you for this time together, Lord, and bless this time in your name, amen.
Life is a journey. As you set sail for your voyage, you must prepare yourself for the hardships that may lie ahead and for the new waters that are left untraveled. As a graduating senior, there may be times when the waters you travel get a little rough. Those are the times you need to remind yourself that God will always be there for you to get you back into the calmer waters. God follows you in your adventures and watches over you as your protector. Don't be afraid to turn to him when you need him the most.
We're going to sing that song, My Country, 'Tis of Thee, Sweet Land of Liberty, of Thee I Sing. Amen. Just let it ring from the very depths of your being. It's a very, very familiar song to us all, so we're going to sing it a cappella here this afternoon. My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. My native country, the land of the noble free, thy name I love. I love thy rocks and rills, thy wooden templed hills. My heart with rapture thrills like that above. Let music swell the breeze and ring from.
Hard stuff. Great job.
Song. Let mortal tongues awake, let all that breathe partake, let rocks their silence break, the sound prolong. On the last verse, our Father's God to thee, Author of liberty, to thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom's holy light. Protect us by thy might, great God, our King. Amen. You may be seated. Reverend Kevin Zaborni is going to, from the First United Free Methodist Church, is going to come now to welcome you and also be involved in introducing the ministers and clergy that that work here in our city. And the graduating seniors are going to introduce their fathers and their mother here. And so let's give a warm welcome to Kevin. Amen.
If you notice in the bulletin, it says that you're supposed to stand again. I don't think we'll do that. Instead, we'd like to welcome you to our baccalaureate service of worship. It is a service that is designed by, for, and with the cooperation of the graduating seniors this year, as well as the Ministerial Association, parents, and it's something that has been a tradition in many parts of the country for years. And a lot of school systems, it's not taking place currently, but in some forms it is coming back. Again, it is sponsored at the request of the graduating seniors to the Ministerial Association and parents to make this happen for you. We welcome everybody that is in attendance today. This morning at our church, the First United Methodist Church, we did celebrate the seniors who are graduating, and it is something that you can't have too much of, because in your families and in your homes, and whether there be a party or whether it just be a small get-together, I ask you to acknowledge the work that they've done, because in many ways it's just beginning. Their life is about to take a new direction and a new beginning. And so we look forward to your lives together and make this world a better place. I'd like to ask those of you who have parents, a parent or parents, who are clergy, who are ministers, I ask the graduates to please come up here at this time, and we'd like you to introduce your mother or your father or whoever it is to the rest of the people. You can rise and come on up at your convenience. And we ask the clergy to come up with their child.
My name is Sonya White, and this is my father, Minister Alan White from Life of Faith Fellowship. And Sons Ministry.
My name is Lisa Aho, and this is my dad, Dennis Aho, pastor of Lighthouse Baptist Church.
I'm April Strauss, and this is my mom, Penny Strauss. She's the pastor of the Reorganized Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints.
Hi, I'm Amy Brown, and this is my dad, Stuart Brown, pastor of Servants of Christ Church.
And now I'd like to invite Lisa Aho to come forward for a special song.
Your reward.
Thank you, Lisa. Beautiful song, beautiful message to that song. We have so much to be thankful for, don't we? Thankful for godly parents. I pray that you continue to pray for your parents, you seniors. Parents, you continue to pray for your children. You thank God for going to a place of education like this. And both the Portier High, Portier Northern, maybe you're so thankful for some of the teachers you had. And I pray you continue to pray for your teachers because they have a lot of battles to go through sometimes. And also that you pray for the ministers that are trying to stand on the pulpit week after week and give their very best to deliver the Word of God to you. And I'm just so thankful that we have some seniors that want to read some scripture at this time. But before they come, I'd just again like to thank all the ones that were involved in. I hope all of you pay a close attention on the back of your bulletin that you were given, all the work that has gone into making this service possible. And of course, in a little bit here, we'll be receiving an offering. But I pray that you continue to just give special thanks to some of these people that have made this service possible. So glad that you were able to come here even this afternoon. At this time, we'll have the four come and share in their scripture at this time.
This is from the Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15 through 20, walk in wisdom. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand the evil of the Lord, of what the Lord is, and do not be drunk with wine in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Book of Philippians, chapter 3, verse 12 through 16, pressing toward the goal. Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead. I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, let us, as many as are mature, have this mind, and if anything you think otherwise, God will reveal even this to you. Nevertheless, to the degree that we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule, let us be of the same mind.
Psalms 121:1. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He will watch over you and will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore.
Proverbs 2:1-8. My son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, turning your ear to wisdom and applying your heart to understanding. And if you call out for insight and cry aloud for understanding, and if you look for it as for silver and search for it as for hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom, and from his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He holds victory in store for the upright. He is a shield to those whose walk is blameless, for he guards the course of the just and protects the way of his faithful ones.
I press toward the mark for the prize. Amen. That's what all of our lives should add up to. And I'm so thankful that we have a speaker here today that I believe keeps pressing toward the mark. And some of you have probably heard this speaker on Channel 3 and our local channel here in Port Huron, but I was so thankful to be able to hear our speaker preach a Thanksgiving message this past Thanksgiving, and he just thrilled my heart. He just he lays it out where we can relate with it on a real personal level, and that's what I really appreciate about this man. And I don't know him very well, but I'm so thankful that his spirit and my spirit are basically, we're on the same page, and I'm so thankful for his willingness to come to share with you graduating seniors and you adults here today. So let's give a warm welcome to Reverend Link Howard as he comes.
Good evening, or afternoon. Why don't you do something for me? It's been a little quiet so far. Why don't you reach over and touch the person next to you if you're not too mean and tell them you're in the right place at the right time doing the right thing with the right people. Now, isn't that nice? I am really, really blessed to be here this afternoon. God bless all of these ministers on the roster, and parents, relatives, and especially these graduating seniors. This is your afternoon, but indeed it's also God's afternoon. And it is a joy and a privilege to be here this afternoon. This is not the first time that I've done a baccalaureate here in the city of Port Huron. I did one a number of years ago, and I'm blessed to be able to come back, although I am careful when I say that now, after I have learned something that Placido Domingo once said. Placido Domingo is one of perhaps the two greatest operatic tenors of all time. He talks about how opera goers in New York are very fair, liberal, warm people. They are very understanding and very gracious with opera stars, but it's not necessarily so in Italy, especially in La Scala in Milan, where opera goers there are thoroughly conversant with many of the operas, many of them being Italian. And one particular opera tenor, at the conclusion of the opera, was called out six or seven times at the end of the opera. And every time he came out, they would say, "Ancora, ancora." And finally, with as much humility as he could muster up, he came out and he said, "How many times do you want me to come back out?" And somebody about halfway back said, "Until you finally get it right." So I don't know if I'm here today because they enjoyed me or if they're saying, "We want you to finally get it right." I told my wife when I was preparing to come, I said, "I'm going back to do the baccalaureate." She said, "Oh, you're going back?" I said, "Yes." She said, "Well, you know what they say, if at first you don't." But Lisa truly blessed us with that song. It was outstanding. You're here today not just because you are graduating high school, or not just because you have young people graduating high school, but you're here today because in God's eyes, you're very special. Not just special because you're preparing to graduate, but special because God chose you, the Bible says, before he ever formed the world, and ordained you and fixed it that you would be here. And I just want to tell you how special you are. When your mother and your father, whoever you are, however young or however old you are, got together and decided they were going to have you, there were approximately several million little sperms headed towards that egg. Several million of them. Only one of them made it. Who is that? Point at yourself. That makes you special, because that means that out of several million chances that God had of creating you, God looked down in that process and he looked down and he said, that one. And that was you. Say, I made it. Come on, say it. Say, I made it. And I'm glad to be here. Is there anyone that's not glad to be here? Okay. We don't need Dr. Kevorkian today. Okay. Phil said that he liked my preaching because I made the word personal and applicable. I want to try and do that this afternoon, just for a few minutes. I'm not going to preach very, very long today, but I want to try and make the word applicable to you, something that will help you as you embark upon the next stage of your life. So there's a passage of scripture in the first Psalms that I want to read a portion of. And it says, blessed is the man, Psalms 1, that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. This variety of songs that lament and praise in this book was through most of the Old Testament time unnamed. The Jews referred to it as the Book of Songs. It was later named the Book of Psalms, indicating songs sung to the accompanying of stringed instruments. The entire 150 Psalms does not compose one book, but the Book of Psalms is literally composed of five different books. Psalms 1 through 141 is book 1. Psalms 42 through 72 is book 2. Psalms 73 through 89 is book 3. Psalms 90 through 106 is book 4, and Psalms 107 through 150 is book 5. The Psalms are songs written about thanksgiving, songs written about praise, songs written about judgment, songs written about mercy, songs written about grace, songs written about power, songs written about repentance, songs written about love, about joy, about deliverance, songs asking for deliverance. And also included are what they consider songs of wisdom. Psalms 1 would be classified as a wisdom psalm or a wisdom song. This anonymous wisdom writer gives us some contemporary advice that I think will benefit those of you seated here in front of me this afternoon, and additionally those of you seated on my right and on my left and behind me, because he talks about how to live a happy or a blessed life. Now, I don't think there's anyone here sitting before me today that's going to say, Pastor Howard, I have just prepared myself to graduate through high school, and I think I'm going to be a miserable failure the rest of my life. Is there anyone like that here today? I didn't think so. I think it would be a fair statement to say that all of us want to live happy, successful, blessed, and prosperous lives. If you are like that, let me see your hands. I want to know who I'm talking to. All right, all of us fit in. You all know when you're getting set up too, don't you? The word blessed means happy. It means prosperous. It means to make progress. The writer of the psalm says, blessed is the man, or blessed is the person. And then he gives some advice on things you should avoid if you want to be happy, if you want to be blessed, if you want to be successful. And this is not advice that is contemporary just to young people today, but it's advice that all of us can adhere to in this room today. He says, blessed is the man or woman who first of all walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Now what does that mean? That means that you have got to be careful where you get your advice from. Now, I see a lot of parents' heads up there going, mm-hmm. I know you're at a point now where you feel like, I've done it. I'm ready to jump out there. But you don't know everything yet. I remember a young lady at a church I was affiliated at that was very young at the time, and she was quite articulate for her age. I think she was about 7 or 8. And I was asking her questions, and every question I asked, she answered the question until finally I stumped her. And I laughed, and she said, I don't know what you're laughing at. She said, I know some things, but I don't know everything. You know some things, but you don't know everything yet. And I want you to understand that I couch these in terms of love, because you're going to be faced with some decisions in life. You're going to be faced with some very critical decisions in life, and you're going to have to rely on someone for advice. I'm reminded of what lawyers say: he who represents himself in the court of law has a fool for a client. Well, what does that say about the person who advises themselves? The Bible, your parents, your teachers, your counselors, your ministers are here to advise you on the right decisions to make in life. But the number one resource that you have is the Word of God. If you're homeless and without a parent, without a living relative on this earth, there is enough insight and wisdom in the Bible for you to make every area of your life prosperous. Do you realize that the Bible is so explicit
in the instructions that it gives, that it gets as intimate as to tell you how to treat your mate. Oh, the Bible puts the rubber where it meets the road. We feel like the only way we're going to find out what we need to do is call 1-900-PSYCHIC. I'd hate to check some of our phone bills. We feel like the only way we're going to find out what we need to do is to read our horoscope or have somebody read our palm or something mystic that goes on somewhere. But the Word of God, the Bible says, is so simple and so insightful that a fool could not err in reading it. Be careful where you get your advice from. I know you think your parents don't know anything now. I know husbands sometimes hear things from their wives and it doesn't make sense to them until they hear it from somebody else out in the street. I see some wives shaking their heads now. It's the same way with their children. I've graduated all of my children from high school, and they're endeavoring on in other occupations in life right now. And now that they're older, we sit back and we laugh sometimes how we would tell them something to do, and they would think it was the dumbest thing they ever heard. And then somebody out in the street would tell them the same thing, and it would be like a stroke of genius. Your parents love you. They didn't just get here yesterday. They didn't come down with the rain today. They've been here, learned some things, experienced some things to help you make the right choices. Be careful where you get your advice from. Let me press this along because I've only been given 20 minutes. The psalmist says, blessed is the man that first of all walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. You've got to be careful where you get your advice from. Secondly, he says, nor standeth in the way of sinners. What does that mean? That means that you not only do you have to be careful who you get your advice from, but you have to be careful who you associate with. You can't hang out with losers and expect to be successful. You can't hang out with folks that aren't going anywhere and expect to be successful in life. Because the company you keep is eventually going to influence your mind. I understand how peer pressure works on you. But listen to me, young people. You can't hang out with folks when you go on to college or go on to your profession. You can't hang out with folks that sit around and drink all day and all night, that sit around and do dope all day and all night and think that's not going to influence your mind. If you want to be successful in life, you have got to get yourself around people who have been successful. I say this in no derogation to pastors who pastor churches the size of mine, but I don't want to hang out with pastors that pastor churches my size. I want to hang out with pastors that pastor churches 10 times the size of mine. Because now I have them as a role model, someone to look up to. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. What does that mean? That means that you should not go through life with a negative approach on life. You're not going to be blessed if you go through life as a grumbler and a complainer. Now, I'm going to be real honest with you. I'm the type of person that people that complain all the time, and everybody knows them. Everybody's got friends or neighbors. Every time when you see them coming, you'll find something to do. What are you doing? Oh, I'm busy right now. It doesn't matter what you're doing. Some folks, that you get to the point, and I hate to say it being Christians, but you almost lie. Oh, tell them I'm not at home. Negative people have a tendency to work my nerves. Folks that nothing, have you ever seen folks that nothing in life ever works out for them? They're always complaining. They're always broke. They're always sad. They're always down. Their children are always messed up. Their parents are always messed up. School is not right. Their work is not right. Their job is not right. The people around them is not right. Church is not right. The television is wrong. Everything in life is messed up. But I'm here to tell you today, if you are a child of God, something in your life ought to be working out sometime. God has fixed it so that as a child of God, I don't have to take a negative approach on life, because I'm not a negative person, because I don't serve a negative God. I heard the Bible say, not that I'm down, but I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And you have faith always as part of your theme. That's how you've got to go through life. Not negative and complaining and frowning, but understanding you're somebody special to God. You are God's purchased possession. You're God's child. God picked you out and put his smile and his love inside of your heart. And you're somebody special to God. And you've got to get to a point where you say, listen, I don't care if nobody else loves me. I know somebody that does. Put a smile on your face and go through life being successful. Too many of us go through life negative, but you know how you prepare yourself mentally is how you're going to go through life. There's a thing called self-fulfilling prophecy. You all may have heard it this way. What you say is what you get. If you speak negative things are going to happen to you, because the Bible says words are spirit. So don't go through life with a frowning, scornful attitude. Look at what he says in verse 2. But his delight, speaking of the blessed man, is in the law of the Lord, and in that law doth he meditate day and night. Do you know what that word meditate means? In the Hebrew, it literally means to mutter. It means to repeat God's word over and over and over again until it gets in your spirit. Verse 3, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Listen to me. If you avoid bad advice, if you avoid bad company, if you don't take a negative, frowning attitude on life, but you use the Word of God as your basis for going through life, you can live a successful and prosperous life. You can be blessed. You can go on the next step of your life knowing that you truly can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Now I want to do this as I go back to my seat. I'm going to ask if our graduates would stand for just one moment. And I want to make some positive affirmations, and I want you to point at yourself, and I'm going to ask if you would repeat after me. Say, I am a child of God. I am an heir with God and joint heir with Jesus Christ. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Louder. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Louder. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Louder. I am happy. I am healthy. I am prosperous. I am blessed. Louder. God's favor is on my life. Louder. God loves me. I love me. Now look at the person next to him and tell him, and I want you to love me. You may be seated.
Words are powerful. There's life, and there can be there's life, and there also can be cursing in the tongue. And what we say speaks so much. And I pray that if you have not made Jesus the Lord of your life, if you've not accepted Him as your personal Savior, that you do that before this day is done. Because that's where it all begins. You know, we can say these things, and they can kind of go in our heart, but you know the enemy is going to try to steal what has just been planted in your heart even today. So I pray that before this day is even done, if you haven't accepted Jesus as your Savior, that you do that today. Amen. It's offering time. We are going to receive an offering here, and our mayor is going to come and give you some words of encouragement and also pray. But before he does that, if you are making out a check, we want you to make it out to the Baccalaureate Trust Fund, because there is there's X amount of dollars in the Citizens Federal Bank from the last couple of years that we are able to keep the baccalaureate service going, keep some of the expenses that we have to pay, that we can keep those we can keep the bills paid. So if you want to make a check out, make it out to the Baccalaureate Trust Fund, and the ushers will be receiving, allowing you to give here this afternoon. But we are blessed to have our mayor with us this afternoon, and he's going to come and actually give. I said, hey, take your liberty, address these graduating seniors before we pray, and then after that we're going to have a special song. But let's give a warm welcome to our Mayor Steve Miller.
I have the shortest ministerial staff around. Every time I step up to a podium, I got to lift it up a little bit. I was kind of curious why they would have the mayor of Port Huron come here and pray for money. I don't think our budget's that bad downtown. Most of our bills are paid, and as far as I know, we're debt-free, so maybe that's the reason. It is good to be here. I am a byproduct of the Port Huron Area School District, and having gone through the process you are, I look back and think of the fact that you entered high school entering puberty, and you exit high school entering adulthood. And I think back of my own years, the friends I made, and the things that we experienced together. And shortly thereafter, as you will soon experience, one went to Virginia, another went to California, a couple went to Arizona to wrestle. Your life is about to change, and things will take on a whole new meaning. And people you thought were going to be greatly successful somehow disappointed us. And some people you didn't think were going anywhere somehow, for some reason, rose to the cream of crop. They had something in them that compelled them to move on in life and become something of significance. They take some role in a community, or some role in a business, or some role in a ministry, or some aspect of life in the community in which they excel. And no one would have ever expected it. And just to follow up, because this is getting late, I just want to iterate a little story that I recently heard. When I was 17, 18, we went down on a trip to Florida. And there was a song in a group that was very popular at the time. And the group was called Kansas, a rock group. And they had this song. And for some reason, I was drawn to the song. And it was called Dust in the Wind. And I could never figure out what the author, the singer, was trying to get across to us. But the theme, or the overriding theme of the song, kept on going, we are nothing more than dust in the wind, we are nothing more than dust in the wind. And it had a nice melody, and we drove home down to Florida and back in this motorhome. And a couple years ago, I heard this guy interviewed. And he was reflecting back on his life and the reason he wrote the song. And he says, you know, here I am. He says, I was the pinnacle of success. He says, I had money oozing out my pockets. I had everything you'd ever want. I had women screaming for me like crazy at all the concerts. He had these beautiful homes and nice cars. I traveled anywhere in the world. And he said, it dawned on me that I had no purpose and no reason to my life. And I reflected back, and he says, I realized that my life was meaningless, and I was nothing more than dust in the wind. Later through his life, through a chain of events, he found his purpose, he found his destiny. After all the benefits he had in life, he is now a minister in a small church somewhere down south. Instead of having thousands of women, he has one. Instead of rich and popular, he's obscured and unknown. And yet he has found peace, and he's found happiness, and he found purpose. If I would say anything to you, is find your purpose. Find your reason for being. Cherish these friendships. My wife and I, 18 years out of school, still meet regular, still meet these friends that we acquired in our high school years. They're abiding, lasting, and deep friendships. We don't see them quite as often. Our lives have moved on. We have fathered and mothered three children, and we're still in the process. But these friendships that you have acquired in these days will go with you a lifetime. These memories, these hurts, these pains, they'll go with you. But to be successful, find your purpose, find who you are, establish your convictions, and go forward, because the future's bright. And I just tell you, dream big dreams and be all you could be. Now, if we could for a minute, just bow in prayer, and I'll pray over the offering that's going to be taken, and then we'll move on in the service, wrap this up. Our gracious Father, we are thank you for this opportunity to gather here today, for the Ministerial Association and the students who sponsored and put this baccalaureate on. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to give that next year's graduating class will have the opportunity for a baccalaureate, and to help us underwrite the cost and pay for the Bibles that are being distinguished to the youth who are now emerging as adults and entering into a world with the word in their hand. Lord, bless this offering. May it be useful in the future to continue these baccalaureates and for the future graduating classes. Lord, we want to thank you and ask all this in the precious name of Christ. Amen.
We're going to give... I'm going to have to apologize to some of you, because I've made some real blunders in this in the bulletin here. But one of those is that I forgot to put our special presentation as far as giving a gift to our speaker. So if you could come at this time and present that to Brother Howard, Link Howard. Let's give our two officers a hand as they present this to the to our speaker. Okay. Just a special remembrance of this baccalaureate service. I mean, I think you'll really appreciate that gift, Brother Howard. At this time, we are going to be favored by a number from a former graduate of Port Huron High. You'll be able to tell by the color dress that she has on and what school she's from. But let's give a warm welcome to Debbie Carson as she comes and sings a song.
You don't have to be afraid. what you need. He'll